Good evening, everybody. This is Lionel, aka Cadaverific, and welcome to another podcast for the two or three people that are watching. I mean, it's only second episode, you know. I don't expect overnight stardom, but if I could get some, that would be great. So yeah, let's just shoot right in. So I was thinking I'd do these like every day or every second day or something, but you know what? I decided I've got a lot of time now. I'm going to do them whenever I feel like I want to talk to somebody and nobody's around. So I'm going to just record my thoughts, you know, because if I do this across a mic with the record button hit and upload it to YouTube, it's not clinical insanity. I don't think, you know, it's insane to talk to myself, but it's not insane to talk to myself, record it, and then put it on the internet. The world is a strange place when you think about it. I mean, it's like that old adage, if you, what is it? You pray to God, you're fine, but if God was to talk back to you, you're a bit insane, you know? You go to church every day and you say you hear the voice of God in church, but if you heard the voice of God through your toaster, there'd be a fucking problem, and there'd also be a padded room for you. So these are just, I mean, that's what I'm going with here. I'm hoping I'm not going insane. Like I said in my last video, I had a little bit of a relationship problem, and I did start speaking to myself in order to just verify certain things. Needless to say, talking to yourself is very fun. Cause the brain, the voice inside your head it's something different. Like, you can lie to yourself when your voice is in your head. You can't lie to yourself when you say that shit out loud. Like, you'll come up with shit, the worst stuff in your head. By the way, I know I'm going completely off tangent. By the way, who really controls shit around here? Cause, your brain keeps you walking, keeps you breathing, keeps you alive, you know? But it also shows you pictures of your ex, it shows you memories, it imagines the most beautiful scenarios to torture yourself, and you're like, bro, why are you doing this, you know? I thought we were in this together. I feed you, you stay alive, you keep me breathing autonomically so I can go do some shit. Eventually I'll go to the gym, I'll get us some sex so that you can release some feel-good endorphins. You get high, I get laid, like, it's supposed to be good for everybody. But no, he just decides, well, this isn't working for me. So, I think I'm just gonna show you, what your life could have been before it took you to this point, recording yourself, talking in a closed room. So that makes your brain not the most, you know, perfectly evolutioned my ass. Your brain is like the shittiest roommate you've ever had in university.
Was that your shit? Sorry, I didn't know, even though your name was fucking on it. I mean, it's only cheese. But don't touch my cheese.
So that's that. Okay, so what did I want to talk about? Well, we started on the topic of women. We're going to keep it on the topic of women. And basically what I wanted to talk about, three things I wanted to talk about in this video. And one of the things was, one night stands. I can't do them. Because movies are bullshit. Movies make this crap out to be like some amazing thing that you're gonna do. You know, you're gonna go there and you're gonna say the right words, you know, and you're gonna get the girl and you're gonna take her home and, you know, and it's gonna be magical and blah, blah, blah. No. No. Cause you know what happens? And every guy who's in your own success story succeeded in picking up a woman from the bar, you've hit that moment where the movie didn't tell you what to do. So it gave you all the lines of what you were going to say when you woke up. You bought her a drink. You played it cool. You lit her cigarette. You know, and everything was suave and sexy and fine. And then what happened? She was like, yeah, let's go back to your place. And stop. What happens in the movies then? What happens? They give each other that little sly look, you know? Everything goes fine. The music cuts out. Switch scene. We're in her bed. I'm already throwing her down. We're making out. Everything's all cool. Or you might not even got that far. You might be already in the doorway unlocking the keys. You know, unlocking the door with the keys. Already making out. You know, by the way, just take 2 seconds to open the fucking door. Don't be making out and then trying to put the keys in backwards. You're not impressing anybody. You're just making it super awkward. Because eventually, if that lasts longer than 5 seconds, it's just going to be embarrassing for everyone. She's going to go, oh my God, get it in already. Before you've even gotten into the bedroom. That, you don't want that. So just put the keys in and they get down to business. Now, if you want to do it in the hallway, that's all fine. But I digress. You skipped. They skip in the movies from the bar scene to the bedroom scene. They don't tell you about that. You want to come home with me? Yeah, sure. And then you live like 15 minutes away, so you gotta drive there. They don't tell you what to fill that up with small talk, because those movies are assuming that in that 15-20 minutes between you leaving the bar and you going home, you didn't fuck it up. You didn't say anything that she could have walked away with. And as we gloriously know through life, men fuck shit up by what they say. You could have been in there. You could have been in there. You, like, it could have been perfect. And she's thinking, I'm gonna go home with him. I'm gonna fuck his brains out. I don't even like to give head, but I don't know why the woman I'm impersonating is Southern. I do terrible accents. I'm sorry. I'm not putting on a female voice. Just deal with it. You know, she could be thinking to herself, oh my God, I don't actually give head, but I'm gonna give this guy head because he was just so suave. And then all of a sudden you're in the car. The phone rings. She's giving you a, you know, she maybe decides to lean over and undoes your zip and was like, I'm going to fill this silence by filling my mouth. You know, you're getting a little racy. Then all of a sudden the phone rings and it's his mom. And you're like, as a woman, you're like, okay, well, I guess we're pausing. And then as he picks up the phone while driving, which is a crime. So that's already strike one. You know, he picked up the phone while driving. So fuck your life, right? But then he picks up the phone, talks to his mom. And then when you stop, he leans over and he goes, no, it's fine. Keep going. You really want to be that? There you go. He fucked it up. Men can ruin your chances they ruin their own chances at the drop of a hat, and movies skip over that. I don't want a movie on how to pick up a woman at the bar. I want a movie that details what I'm supposed to do after I get her. That 15-20 minutes of don't fuck it up between getting her home. I want that. Give me that. But I haven't met one of those yet. Amy Schumer's new movie, what was it called? It's got John Cena in it. You get to see John Cena naked. You basically get to see John Cena naked. If you ever feel like you gym and you look good, go watch that movie. I think it's Trainwrecked? Or something like that. Go watch that movie. And see John Cena naked. Then go to the gym. It's fine. No amount of push-ups. There is a certain amount of push-ups, and John Cena did those certain amount of push-ups in order to look like John Cena. But, yeah, don't watch that scene with your lady. Just don't. Plus, I think he's gay in the movie, but it's really funny and really well done. I suggest seeing that movie. Amy Schumer's great, and John Cena's just amazing. And he wrote all of his own jokes. Okay, but, again, huge digress. Picking up women at the bar. Yeah, man, I just don't do it. I mean, it's not that I can't do it. I mean, I have ended up chatting up women, making out at bars. A couple of them I end up dating, and you can talk to all of them, and they'll probably all give you the same question. You know, that I'm just like, they're just like, oh, how did you end up dating Lionel? How did you end up dating Cadaverific? They don't really say the second part. And they'll say, well, you know what? Some of them will say he's funny. Maybe that's true, but a lot of them are just like, well, you know what? He's persistent. I think that's my greatest feature, that I'm able to just be persistent. And that's another thing. I got that shit from Hollywood. That was bad as well. It's always like, oh, go after the one you want. You know, women love it when a guy doesn't give up. You know, yeah. You also don't show me movies about where's the line, In every movie, it works out. He persists. Finally, she smiles and she's like, okay, I'll go on a date. And it's the best thing ever. And they were meant to be soulmates. You don't tell me that point where it's like, you know, oh yeah, I'm gonna pursue. And the next thing you know, the cops arrive and it's like, we have a restraining order against, from Sally to you, you know, Harry. And he's like, oh, that girl, she's still playing hard to get. And it's like, no, this is a federal restraining order. Stay the fuck away from me. They don't show you that. They don't show you what's good and what's way too far. You think John Cusack would be able to get away with that, holding a boombox up in the rain outside her house nowadays? No. Cops gonna roll up on your ass, bro. You going to jail, boy. Like, that ain't gonna work. It ain't gonna work anymore. The rules change. The game changes as it goes on. And by the way, you 16, 17, 18-year-olds, you're physically looking a lot older. Stop it. Because I physically don't look 26, and it's confusing. I'm not a pedophile, but damn it, do you make hunting hard. You know? I was staring at a girl the other day, and I was like, ooh. And my friend looked over, and he's gay, so his age dar is beautiful, like, on point. He's like, she's at least 16. And I'm like, well, and three people turned to the table, because we were eating before we went to Star Wars. Three people turned from the table, and I'm like, cool. So, there's the pedo. You know, I don't need that kind of stress in my life, you know? And some of you are actively going out looking for older guys, knowing that you're probably going to get them to break the law, because statutory rape is fine, because women don't get punished for it. No, fuck it, stay away. But at the same time, older women are intimidating as hell, because older women only go for much older men. So I've got to hunt women. I'm 26. I only want to get women between the ages of 23 and my age. Line up five blondes between the ages of 18 and 23. 18, 19, 21, 23. I think that works out. Between the ages of 18 and 23. Tell me you can tell the difference. Some of those chicks, no, you can't. And I'm hunting here. You see, it's difficult. Cause y'all can hide with makeup. Y'all got the bras to push it up. You got the pants to push it in. You got the corset to push it out, or whatever you gotta do. Dudes, we ain't got that shit. We ain't got nothing. You born a dude. You born an ugly dude. That's it. Cool. Hope you get some money later on in life. Go into IT. Go into hard IT. Go into programming IT. Be that guy. Be the guy that has two office chairs with the left and right of each one gone, and then he jerry-rigged himself an even bigger chair just so that he could swivel around. And then earn your millions being the best programmer. And then get a chick. And, you know, she'll say it's for love. You'll say you love her. You both know it's not because of that. You give her the cash. Once a week, she'll give you a handjob. That's how it's going to work, you know? But you do what you got to do to be happy in life. But I can't be happy getting with somebody and knowing that she could be younger. And Tinder helps, and Tinder hurts. I'm sure Timber hurts as well. I mean, that's why they yell it before the tree fucking falls. lame. But Tinder tells you the age, which is great, tells you the age. But Tinder lies, because I myself, I'm an average-looking guy. Like, I look slightly above average. If I'm going to rate myself, I'm like a 7. 7. And if you say I'm not a 7, I want to see what your version of a 7 is, because you're probably a shallow motherfucker. But I'm probably a 7. But with voice and comedy and how I can sell myself and just be like really, really funny, that pushes myself up. It's very funny to be hard in a Tinder profile. Like, it's very hard to be funny in a Tinder profile. I can't do it that well. And that assumes that she's looked at your picture. I mean, you can put some stuff there that's funny, but that assumes that she's looked at your picture. You're just below, like, where she'll go, and then clicked your picture just to read what you put there. And then you get some funny stuff. And even then she might say no. So I've got an extra layer of security to try and get a swipe right. And I've had two swipe rights on Tinder in the last month that I've been there. One of them never came on again. And the other one was an English person studying in South Africa. And I was an Irish person studying in South Africa. So she must have been like, oh, yo, my friend across the ocean. Fuck you. Irish hate English. Check a fucking history book. So yeah, that's my, it's difficult being a dude. And before you even say, yes, it's harder being a woman. There are many problems. I know I could always vote, and I could always go hunt, and I could always hit you, and it wasn't a problem until about like 30 to 50 years ago. But damn it, women have a power, and we all know the power. It's the mental, like a woman says something to you, and it's a ticking time bomb, and it just sits there, and you know, she'll look at you, and she'll just be like, you know, no, I don't want something for my birthday. Yes, you can go out with your friends. No, I'm just going to stay at home alone. No, everything's fine. And if a dude said that to his friend, we'd be like, cool. But a woman says that to you, and you go, cool, and you turn around slowly, and inside your brain, there's a Mobius strip on a Rubik's cube on an Enigma in a glass vial chest with a super encryption of your brain all of these combinations come together to figure out what did she mean when she said, okay. Because no, I don't believe it's okay. No. And then you walk back in the room and you're like, no. Tell me really. Can I go out? Are you sure? And then she's like, yes, go. It's completely fine. And some people go and it's fine. But the thing is, you don't hear about those stories because it's an unenveloped story. You hear about the story about the woman who said it was fine. Guy went out to play soccer or play American football or wherever the fuck you are, whatever country you're at, the most prevalent football at the time or the prevalent sport at the time, came back and his shit was on the porch. On fire. In his car. Which is also on fire. Like, that happens. So, it's scary. It's scary dating a woman. It's scary being with a woman. It's good. But, sure, man, it's just, you know, women have, like, with dating and picking people up, women have it a little bit easier. I mean, they have a lot more dangers as well, but at the same time, you can, if I put it, okay, if a guy walks into a bar and says, I'm horny, who wants to fuck me? Going to jail. Woman walks into a bar and says, I'm, let's say a five or up, depending on what your scale is, walks into a bar and just shouts, I'm horny, who wants to fuck me? Yeah, they might call the cops. Guaranteed she's going to be carted out by somebody way before that happens. The dude who screamed that, he's going to get rugby tackled, American football tackled, or again, whatever sport's in your country, tackled, and has a tackle, he's going to get that tackled down, is going to be held until the cops come. There's no problem. Women can go out. I had chick friends when they were 21, 22, who said, oh, we're going out drinking, and then said, what do you do? Well, you said you were broke. It's like, I know, but I have these, and then point to their D's, and then just have a low cut top on them, like, so we'll be fine with drinks. And they come home drunk with no dudes. Like, that happened. I can't go do that, mainly because, you know, short shorts really don't look that good on me. You know, I got amazing coughs, so I can wear shorts, but short shorts, nah, my thighs need some toning. Like, women, it's just a completely different game, man. It's the comparisons are fun. I mean, we all know the comparisons. This has been done to death in comedy, but, pardon me, it's just one of those things that's always fun to talk about and know about. And, I love sex, though. Sex is good. Don't get me wrong. Sex is good. I'm not going to make any jokes about that. I saved that for another one. Yo, sex is nice. So I'm not going to lie. I do miss that. But then, you know, you can turn around and, this is based on a true story. You can turn around and, you know, you can have the most amazing sex with that woman and you could be leaving bite marks and hand marks all over each other and you're like, oh yeah, this is the shit I do like. And you feel you'll never be that happy again. She's looking at you with those craven eyes. Not those, I want to take you home to my mom. I just like, I want to, you know, it's just like that hurt me daddy eyes, those ones. You could be doing that. And then you could lie together with, like, immense passion afterwards. And you're like, oh, that was amazing. All sweaty, glistening body. Best 5 to 10 minutes of your life. And then all of a sudden she turns around and screams. And you go, what's wrong? And she goes, you touched me with your feet. You see? Am I alone in this? Did this just happen to me? I'm sure this has happened to somebody else. I mean, that's a thing, right? I mean, women, it's just, it's like Cat Williams said, no guy is ever going to be undressing a woman, kissing her, about to have sex, and then just look, and her fingernails are red, and her toenails are green, and then just go, bitch, you don't even, like, match? I can't even look at you right now, completely unaccessorized woman? Like, no, never going to happen. No. So, that's my 19 and a half minutes on men versus women, specifically with bar picking up. So basically my summary is women are scary, spontaneous, and let me know what to do between the bar and home. I just need to know what to do there. Okay. So, let's move on to the, to the next mini topic as I bridge to the second largest topic, the mini topic I want to talk about. Rock and roll. Old school music. I have a lot of different tastes in music. I mean, currently I'm on a kind of a EDM clubby phase, trap music and glitch hop and things like that. Things you'll probably have to Google afterward, and when you do, you won't like it. But there's a lot of stuff on my PC, on my computer, my phone, that I like old school stuff. And one of the things that I did, like, I'm talking like, I like Lynyrd Skynyrd. I like old school Metallica. Everything before Saint Anger and up to and including a bit of Saint Anger, but not the whole thing. Saint Anger, yeah. I'm talking about like Lynyrd Skynyrd, even though they're flying Confederate flags. I'm talking about like, let me go to my music folder and just have a look at the stuff that I had. So I'm talking about like, I've got everything. I've got old school rock from the 70s to 80s. I love punk rock from the early 2000s because those are the anthems. Those are my teenage anthems. You'll always love the music that you started having sex to. So punk rock, like, for instance, Billy Talent in the background. Yep. Blink-182 running in the background. I had all the small things running through my head the first time I had sex, which now that I think about it is not a Freudian slip or anything like that, so don't you dare even think into that. It was just because it was like Blink-182, so fuck you guys who are laughing. Okay, what are we looking at? We're looking at Billy Talent. We're looking at Bullet for My Valentine. Great. We're looking at Dragon Force, because Through the Fire and Flames. Okay, that's not old school, but I'll get to that. What else? So this is my varied rock music. So we got Flyleaf as well. Foo Fighters. Oh, Foo Fighters. You know, from Nirvana as well, which Nirvana's also on the list. Foo Fighters and Nirvana. God, you gotta love Dave Grohl. You gotta love Dave Grohl and Kurt Cobain. You know, the drummer from Nirvana looks like the lead singer. Ha, I'm not making that joke. But just good, good music. The ones that you just pick up the album, you just love every single bit about it. Who else have I got here? Linkin Park. Got some good Linkin Park, you know. Again, early 2000s, what you grow up having sex with. Hybrid Theory. Oh, probably single-handedly spawned the emo phase, the mainstream emo phase. What else? You know, Metallica. Yep. We got, Motorhead. Motorhead. Gotta love that Ace of Spades, man. Gives me, got the goose pimples. Like, just that voice. 7 or 11, Snake Eyes watching you. So good. So good. You just, no matter where you are, that song, yeah, you just rock out. Side note, white people anthem, Scotty doesn't know. White person anthem, don't know, don't care who you are. If you're in a predominantly English-speaking country, you pop that on, every single white person, and probably the other people as well, will start singing that song. But it's like a, ever since that movie came out, it was imprinted into the genetics, the epigenetics of every single fucking white person who watched that movie and listened to that song. Scotty doesn't know the Fiona in me. And I'm half white, so I can sing the song too. Do it in my van every Sunday. Like, so good. So good. By the way, it's not Matt Damon's band. It's another band. Matt Damon just like copied it for the movie, so. Great. My Chemical Romance. Again, emo phase of your teenage years. I was never emo. You know, it was just, I could never be that committed to being sad. Because it was just too fun. Being nice. Nightwish. Oh, wow. Forgot I even had that. Nightwish. Great, great. Pre-Nightwish before they changed the lead singer. Even though Nightwish, the band, is actually not the name of the lead singer, it's the name of the bassist. But Nightwish, before they changed the operatic lady for the first two or three albums and they switched it to somebody else. That pre-Nightwish, pre-switch Nightwish, great, great music. Nirvana as well. Oh, y'all remember Ocean Avenue? Ooh, that was the stuff right there. Ocean Avenue, oh. Wow, what was it? Ah, if I could find you now, things would get better. Oh, that was good. Not even emo, it was just very, very, you know, not even punky, just very, very slightly jovial punk, yeah. Paramore, love me some Haley John. What's her name? Haley Williams? Haley Williams? Haley Johnson? Haley Williams. I think it's Haley Williams, yeah. Although I think she's a fake ginger, a fake redhead, because I don't smell anything off her. I have a thing for gingers, but I don't smell anything, so, you know. Queens of the Stone Age. Love. Me some fucking Queens of the Stone Age. Oh, got a good few of their albums. Oh, Era Vulgaris is it's just good. But my theme songs go with the flow. So that's just there. Side note. Do you know that the song Go With The Flow was apparently about the lead singers, what's his name? Ugh, I think it's like Josh Holm. I know that there's somebody who was listening who was screaming out, Holm! Yeah, Josh Holm. Do you know that song, Go With The Flow, was apparently written because somebody found pictures of his sister or family member, female, who was working at a strip club. And the whole song is about him coming to grips with it and saying, like, you know, she said I'd throw myself away. They're just photos after all. I can't make you hang around. I can't wash you off my skin. And all the lyrics are just about him, like, not all the lyrics. I mean, little soldiers in a row falling in a lot of love. I think that's that reading in. It could be a euphemism for the little soldier sitting in the front row of the stripping stage, falling in out of love, because she fall in love with the girl whose jugs you're seeing, but she falls right out of love. When she picks up your money, walks away, then another one comes out, you know? It's just how it happens. So, very, very cool. Tenacious D, but that's just for comedy. Bloodhound Gang as well, early 2000s, great comedic band, also very good rock band. Offspring and the Pretty Reckless. Two way different spectrums of the bands, but looking good. I love me some Offspring. From Nana, Why Don't You Get a Job, and Pretty Fire for a White Guy, all the way through. Sum 41, Blink 182, all of these. But that's punk rock. My old school rock has, like, Guns N' Roses, Skid Row, Triumph and Agony. Triumph and Agony, from Warlock, my bad. Skid Row. There is some Nickelback, but not a few Nickelback, okay? Don't crucify me for that. Iron Maiden. Can I Play With Madness? Used to have a lot of these. I tried to put them on a gym mix, and they didn't really work as, like, pumpy stuff. But Iron Maiden, Offspring, Whitesnake, Here I Go Again. Here I go again on my own. So good. Just so good as a song. It's just got that... Music back then, there was like barely anything good on TV. These were the times when kids, rebels, got the records, were rebelling against their parents. It was the first ones. Cause the 60s and 50s didn't have no rebellious parents. Because they're the grandparents now, and they still have a stick up their ass from when they weren't allowed to rebel. But the 70s, 80s, the rock crew, males having female hair, that was the outstanding point. That was, we're gonna be what we wanna be. We're not gonna conform. And to not conform, our main thing is we're gonna wear makeup. As men, we're going to wear makeup, we're going to do whatever we want to do, we're going to put makeup on our face like Kiss, we're going to grow long hair, you know, from 70s rock to glam rock, that kind of thing. It was a whole rebel phase, and that's why you had, like, Bang Your Head from Quiet Riot, like, just, you know, just anthems, like, was there a dance to Bang Your Head? No, it's in the lyrics, fucking bang your head, that's what you did. Don't Need Nothing But a Good Time. You know, for a good time. Oh, so good. Just those anthems, you know, that people will just, I love it. Journey, 69 Eyes, even Seether, but again, not that time. Megadeth, Scorpions, No One Like You. I can't sing at all, by the way. Motley Crue. How did I forget Motley Crue? So great. I mean, this was good. And I was reminded of this now because I was looking around and thinking, you know what? Every so often, there's music that has a place in your heart and there's music that you like today. And how this holds you is those are the two types, and all of your music then splits into different genres. So you're going to have music that you like now and you're going to have music that you will always like from then. And the music that you like now is like myself is the EDM crap, the glitch hop, the trap. But that's changed. I mean, previously, before that, I was doing fucking Frank Sinatra and folk rock. And Oaks playing with banjos, but not from a trailer park in the USA. Like, you know, your musical tastes evolve. But the music that you'll always like is, I believe, A, the music that you started, that you was playing when you started having sex, and B, because you'll always associate the sex with the great memories, and then that's the music you got in the background, which is why I always liked Johnny Flynn, because I was always playing that in the background my recent years. But old school rock, I had such amazing memories with friends who introduced me. Because I'm colored, so I had I had black friends and colored friends, and I listened to rap for the longest time. And the only rock I ever got introduced to was like with Linkin Park teamed with Jay-Z. But when I hung out with different groups of friends, predominantly white guys who are rockers, and I started playing guitar with them, and then they gave me all of this music, like I could feel it. I could feel where all of this came from. I could feel just where people would like sing about stuff, especially like. Like when you go through certain things in your life, there's always a song out there that can talk about what you're going through perfectly. And one of my favorite old school bands that do that is a band called Airborne, Australian. They sound very much like AC/DC. But they'll have songs like, Runnin' Wild. And it's just basically him singing about, what's the lyrics, the first few lyrics, I got the wind to my back and my foot to the floor. I ain't coming back for you no more. I'm sick of your shit and your moaning ways. It made me feel good driving right outside. Like, it's him leaving a woman, leaving somebody, I'm assuming it's a woman, but it might not be a woman. It could be a family member. It could be a best friend. It could be a job or something like that. But it's just him putting all his shit in a car, putting his foot down, and just fucking driving. And it makes you imagine a world where you could do that, where there's no cars in the road, and it's sunset permanently, and you got the black glasses on, you're wearing the leather with the top-down car, but you're not sweating, because you're too cool to sweat. I think that's a song as well from the album, Too Cool to Sweat, or something like that. But, and you're just going, and your new life, new adventure, new woman is on the other side of that endless road. I'm imagining this in like Kansas or Nevada, by the way. I mean, it just gives you that vision. And it's really, really good. I mean, they have another song, Diamond in the Rough, which completely flipped over. He's talking about, a woman's diamond in the rough. Talking about that and how he can't focus on anything in life. Can't focus on anything in life because all he wants to do is just crawl back into bed with this amazing, beautiful woman and everything about it. It's Airborne, Diamond in the Rough. It's amazing. And then they have, of course, all rock songs back then. What did they have? They had a fight song. They had a fight song. Not to say, I'm going to kill you, like fight music, like Eminem, like it's going to go and we're going to like die and like people, they won't find your body. I'm talking about back then, the rock fight music was basically two people standing there and they were basically just trying to outdo each other. Like guys do, you know, you throw the disses and whoever throws the best diss wins. And this is what that music was. It was, this is what we're about. And then the other guy would be like, well, this is what we're about. And whoever had the best song would win. There would be no fists involved. That's what the spirit of that music was. And, Airborne had a song called, Stand and Deliver, which was a great, I highly suggest just finding Running Wild, Diamond in the Rough, and Stand and Deliver, and just listening to that stuff. And so, yeah, what was the thing? Yeah, just, you know, you have that amazing feel for all of them. I mean, like Motley Crue had Going Out Swinging. I mean, just old school rock, man. You have to love old school rock and roll. That's just how it is. It's the feelings that they made you feel. I mean, even the love songs. You want to talk love? You get a man. Long hair and makeup on a guitar telling you he loves you. Oh, that is it. That is it. What's the song of I have in my head now? I hope this is old school rock because it feels very old school in my head. It's like, if I die tomorrow. Wait, you know what? Fuck it. I'll just search if I die. Hopefully. Yeah, Motley Crue. Yep. If I Die Tomorrow. Oh, what a song. What a song. That guy, you know, maybe he did love somebody. Maybe he didn't. Maybe he's just singing for the hell of it, but like, damn, that's some good music. I mean, oh, just old school rock and roll is where it was at, man. I mean, new rock is good. New Rock was good, but I always just find myself going back to the pretty much that old school stuff. And you will, you will. You're always going to find something like that that just brings you back. Okay, so that's my my rock segue. I just wanted to talk about that for a moment. Sorry if you don't listen to rock, but you probably caught up with the music during sex things. So, you know, first time you ever spank a girl's ass from behind, whatever song is playing in the background, you better hope it's a good one, because you're going to remember it. All right. Now, the last thing I want to talk about in this upload is the... Okay, now, there is a great director out there that's doing a lot of work. You may know him from doing Buffy. You may know him from doing Serenity and Firefly. It's Joss Whedon. But there's Joss Whedon, right? He's a great director. And I liken Kevin Feige and Joss Whedon, what they did with the Avengers and the whole Marvel Cinematic Universe, what they did to just be absolutely, utterly fantastic. It was an amazing thing. Nobody could have seen that doing that could have achieved what it was going to achieve, you know, linking all those movies together. I mean, it took a chance, but you got to get some good actors in to be able to tie something like that together. And they did, in the form of Robert Downey Jr., which everybody has spoken about, was just an absolutely amazing casting decision. He is not Robert Downey Jr., he is Tony Stark. Now, I will say this. There have been some choices that I did not like. There are just certain movies that I want to talk about that are not even part of the Marvel Universe, that if they were any worse might have crippled the plan. Number one, The Hulk. And I'm not talking about The Incredible Hulk with Eric Norton. And I'm not talking about Mark Ruffalo's Hulk. I'm talking about that piece of shit that happened, like, ages ago with Eric Bana. Like, just terrible. Just a bad, bad movie. Like, bad camera angles. They trapped him in foam. Like, it was just, it was a terrible movie. It was just really, really bad. And then they got Eric Norton in to play Bruce Banner in The Incredible Hulk, which was a great movie, beautiful movie with Liv Tyler opposite, and that guy from Modern Family, Ty Burrell, I think is his name. Great, great movie. But apparently, he wanted to be paid more for doing the Avengers movie, and they already knew that they were going to put this all out on the back of Robert Downey Jr. So no, sorry, you can't get paid more than that. This is our guy. This is what we're doing. And because of that, you know, he quit, and then we got Mark Ruffalo, who is in himself an amazing Hulk as well. But strangely enough, did you know in the comics that there's not just like one Hulk, there's like several different shades of Hulk as well. There's like there's Green Hulk, there's Super Hulk, there's Grey Hulk, and depending on his relationship with Banner, it depends on how much intelligence the Hulk gets. If it's a forced turn, then the Hulk will be more animalistic. If it is a controlled turn where Banner wants to turn, the Hulk is smarter. But there have been times in the comics as well where you have Banner has stayed permanently as the Hulk and being able to access intelligence for full conversations. There was a time when he was Mr. Grey and acted as a bodyguard in the comics, and he was still huge. He was like 6'10", 7 foot tall, built like a brick shit house. But he was smart, and he worked as a mechanic as well. But these were times where he wasn't Bruce Banner. He was still the Hulk accessing higher intelligence. So the Hulk has looked different through many, many years of comic books. And strangely enough, in a way, the different versions of the Hulk that we've gotten and the different actors that we've gotten to play him have actually kind of paralleled that. Mistakenly paralleled it, but they have paralleled that bring about in the movies, and I really find that quite ironic. Now, here's another thing. Peter Parker there are very, very many different universes in those terrible English. There are many different universes in Marvel. There's this straightforward Earth 616 universe. There is the the Age of Apocalypse universe. There's the Ultimate Universe. And there are different Peter Parkers in each one as well. I mean, in the straight 616, we have normal Peter Parker, now who I think is getting to the age of 27, 28 and has Parker Industries, and is actually a competitor now out of college, a professor, and is competitor to Tony Stark, which is great. In the Age of Apocalypse universe, he fully mutated into his six-armed humanoid form, and is just, I think he's Pestilence. He's one of Apocalypse's horsemen of war. Really weird. But, here's the thing. In the Ultimate Universe, there is no Peter Parker. There is a character called Miles Morales. And Miles Morales is a black Hispanic, is a African-American Peter Parker. He's Miles Morales. And he got his powers kind of the same way, and he had no mentor. He had nobody to teach him what to do. And in a crossover event, Miles Morales met Peter Parker, and Peter Parker schooled him and told him, with great power comes great, you know, repeated lines over the course of 50 years, and taught him how to be. And Miles Morales has become an amazing Spider-Man in his own universe. He's even funny. The only other Parker is Miguel O'Hare, which is the Spider-Man of 2099. It's a future-set Spider-Man. But that's neither here nor there. What I was going to say is, mirroring the changes that we've had with the Hulk, we've had two different Peter Parkers in the last, 15 years? Two different Peter Parkers, five different movies, going on a sixth in Civil War and a seventh afterwards, and we're on our third Peter Parker. That shit don't fly. Like, I understand that you can kind of do that with the Hulk, as I bolt up now, but you can't do that with Peter Parker. And Tobey Maguire... Okay, let's put one thing straight. Spider-Man 1 was a good movie. Spider-Man 2 was a great movie. Great movie. Spider-Man 3 was a pile of turd. Too much going on. It was just terrible. Astonishing Spider-Man was good. I like Andrew Garfield, not so much as Peter Parker, because he doesn't fit the Peter Parker role. Like, his face isn't even in the same shape. Tobey Maguire was perfect. He had the same face. He was awkward. He was a dork. Like, I could imagine him getting beat up. Like, I could. Like, and that's what Peter Parker was. Andrew, not too much. But Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man was amazing. Way better than Peter Parker's. Like, the other Spider-Man movies, there was no quippiness from Peter. He said, like, maybe one line at a time. But Andrew Garfield was a funny, funny Spider-Man. So that was great. If we had Tobey Maguire doing the Peter Parker scenes, and then we had a switch to Amazing Spider-Man, like, that would be perfect. That would be the ultimate Peter Parker. But that's not what I want to talk about. Now they're rebooting it with another Peter Parker, and he's in high school. They never want to let Peter graduate, and this is the problem. Now, what I want, what I think would be great, is if they took Miles Morales, basically. They dropped Peter entirely, and for Civil War, they had Miles Morales. They had a black Spider-Man. Because we know Peter Parker's origin story. Like, we know who he is. We know the storyline. So, we've seen it twice now in the past 15 years. Like, we know. And if they're going to do the next movie and redo this goddamn origin story, I'm going to flip a lid, because I know Spider-Man's storyline. I know Thor's storyline. I know Iron Man's storyline. I know you had to set those up for the non-comic book reading people, but I know Spider-Man's storyline. So do they now. They've seen it twice. We know he gets bit by something. Like, everybody knows that. It's in a fucking theme song. So I would avoid doing that completely, but if they decided they didn't want to, then my thing would just be, okay, well then, why don't you just use a different Spider-Man? Why don't you use Miles? Like, he's right there. He has his own universe. We can start something new. We can have a new Spider-Man doing new things. Doing these, like, you know, you would have different characters, and it wouldn't just be, oh, it's blackified Peter Parker. You know, it's not that. If you've actually read the comics, they're two completely different characters. It's not just, oh, this is the black version of fucking Peter Parker. No, Miles Morales is his own fleshed out, raw, amazing character. I would, if you're gonna go and reboot the goddamn thing again, do it without Peter Parker. Do it with Miles Morales within the universe. Set that up as the ultimate Marvel universe, and you could explain all of this out. That would be my rant. Sorry that it went from this whole cast went from the final send off notes. This whole cast went from like funny woman stuff to like semi funny rock inspiration to not funny Marvel Comics ranting. But you know, that's just me. It's just what you get. Sorry if you hear that something in the background. There's a fan. So yeah, that was just my ranting talks right now, just to try and get something out. Yeah. So basically, women are scary. Rock is good. And Peter Parker needs to be black. Spider-Man needs to be black. There we go. So thank you for listening to the Cadaverific Conversations. And I shall, talk to you in the next podcast, which I may record soon. So, yeah. Thank you.